Now we see the sanctuary of power, and the sanctuary of power is Christ himself. That is the thing that's important. Contemplation of Christ is the sanctuary of power. Now will you listen to verse 8 as I read this? Finally, brethren. Now, this finally, it means business now. The epistle's coming to an end. Before, back in the beginning of chapter 3, he was just halfway through. But now, he's coming to the last point that he's going to make. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Now, where it says lovely here, whatsoever things are lovely, the better word, I think, is gracious, whatever is gracious. Now, someone has called this the briefest biography of Christ that's ever been written, just this verse here, and I think it's a good one. Who's true? Well, he is. He says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Whatsoever things are honest, who is honest? Jesus Christ. Whatsoever things are just, well, he's the just one, and he's going to rule someday in justice and righteousness. It's Christ. Well, whatsoever things are pure, well, who wants to stand up and say you're pure, my friend? I don't think that there are many of us could stand up and say that, but he could say, which of you convicteth me of sin? He's pure. Whatsoever things are lovely or gracious. Oh, how wonderful he was. And whatsoever things are of good report. And if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things. Who is the one we're to praise? And virtue includes more than what we think. It means that which is manly, that which is noble. These are virtues that have gone out of style. You're a squire today if you emphasize these. Well, our Lord was no squire, but he was on the square, and he was one that we can think on him. Now, you and I live in a dirty world. I don't care where you go, you get dirty. You can't walk down the streets of Los Angeles without you get dirty. Your mind gets dirty, your eyes get dirty. Fact of the matter is, you get dirty physically even as you look into this world today. And do you ever get tired of the dirt and the filth of it? And television, oh, I look at it, but what sorry things are on it. What worthless things. Someone has called it the great wasteland. Well, it certainly is today. It's just like looking at an arid desert, and yet their multitudes got their eyes glued to it, and their minds are being filled with dirt and filth and violence and things that certainly do not improve the mind. What can a Christian do? Well, my friend, if you're going to spend your time with the dirt and filthy and the questionable things of this world, you'll not be a Christian with power in your life. The reason today we got so many namby-pambies, so many mollycoddles, so many weaklings in the Christian faith, here is the problem. They spend their time all week with the things of the world, just filling not only their tummies with the things of the world, but filling their minds and their hearts with the things of this world. And then they wonder why there's no power in their lives. How much time do you spend in the Word of God? How much time do you spend contemplating Christ? And that is the thing we were emphasizing back in 2 Corinthians 3rd chapter, verse 18. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed under the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. Now, the Word of God is the mirror, and we're beholding in a mirror the glory of the Lord. How are you going to behold Christ? The only way in the world you can behold the living Christ is in the Word of God. And as you behold him, why, there is a liberty that he gives to you. There is a freedom he gives to you. There is a growth that he gives to you. And friends, you can't come by it any other way than in the Word of God. That's one of the reasons that there is so much weakness today. I am amazed. Oh, I am amazed at how easily Christians are taken in by every wind of doctrine that comes along. They're not actually able to discern the truth and error and any kind of a heresy that meets a responsive chord in the minds and hearts of a great many. And that's disturbed me. Why is it there's so much weakness today in so-called fundamental circles? The one explanation in my mind, as I've stated, it's my judgment, it's just one thing, ignorance of the Word of God. And that ignorance of the Word of God is the reason that there is so much weakness, how puerile, how inconsequential is the impact of the lives of believers today. And just to go out and hand out a tract or spout out the plan of salvation, that's good. I don't mean to belittle that one bit. But my friend, you ought to have a life that backs it up, that's got power in it, because you've been contemplating the person of Jesus Christ and contemplating him in the Word of God. A great many Christians today go to church to be entertained. Someone has said some people go to church to eye the clothes and others to close their eyes. They do not have a worthy motive, even in going to church. And they do not go there to hear the Word of God. They go there to be entertained or go in some kind of a daze and sit there for probably an hour, not any longer, I'm sure, just to feel religious, feel pious. My friend, only the Word of God can bring strength to you. You have to have physical food when you're weak, and you have to have bread and meat if you're going to gain strength. And the Word of God is bread, and it's meat, my friends. And the only way you can grow spiritually is in the Word of God, and as that Word reveals Jesus Christ. And I wish that I could see him on every page of Scripture. In the book of Psalms, when we were there, letter after letter said they did not know Christ was in the book of Psalms as he is. Well, I wish I could have found him more, friends. The problem today is we need to see him. We need to have the reality of Christ in our lives. And the only way that we can do that is with an open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord. And there's a liberty today, and no one has an excuse. No one. I think one of the things that's going to cause many believers to be ashamed at the appearing of Christ is that they come into his presence and they'll be as ignorant as a goat grazing grass on the hillside of the Word of God. And I'm of the opinion he's going to say to many of us, I told you that. I said that to you. And you did not listen. You did not hear me. The problem today with children is they don't listen to their parents. And the problem today with Christians is they're not listening to the Heavenly Father. Contemplation of Christ, that is the sanctuary of power. And many of us need to leave the busyness and the dirtiness of this world and go aside and with the Word of God have a sanctuary for the soul where we can contemplate him, where we can worship him, where we can praise him. Now, we sometimes criticize the Roman Catholics for having some little image up and bowing down to it. Well, I don't agree to that. I mean, I don't agree that you ought to have an image. I think it's wrong. But that's another point. It's not right today for Protestants to live as if he doesn't even exist. He's a reality, and we need to contemplate him and fix our minds on him and not be spending our time criticizing those that maybe are bowing down to an image. And that's just what I've been doing, is disagreeing with them. But the whole point that I'm trying to make is, my friend, the substitute is not to get rid of the idols. The substitute is to turn to him. Remember what Paul said to the Thessalonians? How ye turn to God from idols. You have to turn to Him first. And when you turn from Him, well, you won't need these aids at all. And the only way you can turn to Him is in the Word. Beholding is in a glass, Lord Jesus. The Spirit of God wants to make Him real to us. Many of us are walking afar off today. Oh, that He might bring us in closer. Let me finish this section of the sanctuary with verse 9. Those things which ye have both learned and received and heard and seen in me do, or practice, and the God of peace shall be with you. And you noticed I didn't say that you're to follow me, but Paul gave himself as an example. He is the one that had made Christ the very center of his life, and also the periphery of his life. And when a man lives like that, then he has a sanctuary of the soul.